stand for the reading of the word. Turn with me to the book of Joshua chapter 1. Wow, I need you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Somebody shout, I need you, Jesus. Amen. Glory, glory, glory. Wow. What a beautiful, beautiful presence of God in this place. I'm going to talk about y'all this morning. Is that okay? Anybody like to be talked about? If somebody was talking about you, what would you think? Okay. Would it be okay if it was good? Okay. Would it be okay if it was bad? Okay, it's the divided audience. Some say yeah and some say no. Well, what I want to talk about is not you individually, but yes, it would be individual, but I also want to talk about who you are corporately. Somebody shout with me, I am the church. That's why I want to talk about you, because that's who you are. You are the church of the Most High God. You are the church of the redeemed, and no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. God said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I mean, he's glad you're part of his church. Say with me, it's not my church. It's not your church. It's his church. Go with me, Joshua chapter 1. We've been talking about words in 2017, and I've gotten down to the word remnant. Say the word with me. I just wanted to get it familiar with on your tongue. Remnant. How many has an idea what a remnant is? How many sewers, crafters that have the ability to make quilts or sew things? Yeah, not me. No, definitely not me. How many understand there are remnants that are left over? Well, let's take it on a more, not technical, but more mechanical issue. How many of you ever been putting together, you had screws left over? You might could call that a mistake, and then you forgot something along the way because you didn't read the instructions, or you might could call that, well, that's just extra, that's a remnant. However you want to look at that. Joshua, the word says, verse 1, chapter 1, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, he said, Moses, my servant, is dead. And we understand why Moses didn't go in the promised land, because he disobeyed God. I mean, no, disobedience brings a cost and a price to it. Didn't mean that God stopped loving him, but there was a result. But there was a total different people now going into the promised land, because all those that came out of Egypt were dead, except the children who had now grown up into adulthood. Israel could not go into the promised land, or those that came out of Egypt, because they doubted God. And now a remnant was being taken in. Everybody say remnant. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land that I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. And I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Father, glorious word, powerful word, descriptive word today. God, that I cannot but just read, that I, God, it's just in my spirit today about the church, the remnant. Those that felt like maybe I couldn't do it, the weak, the less intuitive. Maybe the ones that didn't get chosen first or pick up game. God, that's somehow, sometimes how we feel spiritually. We feel like, what have I got to offer? But God, you're looking for a remnant. The people in the midst of difficulty still say, I will trust the Lord. Because God, no matter how the size, God, no matter how weak, you are the one that is strong. No matter the limitations that we have, and no matter how many times we have failed, Micah, the prophet, he had such a great revelation when he spoke out, don't rejoice against me, enemy, for though I fall, I shall rise again. God, today, this church is a remnant that is rising again into a place of glorious impartation because of incredible expectation that the people that know their God shall do great exploits. God, I ask your anointing now. Everything I'm not supposed to say, just keep it in my heart. But everything that you want me to say, God, whether it's on these notes or whether you impress it unto my thoughts and my mind as I declare this and unpack all that you've, Lord, I believe you've given for today. God, just bring it forth to the forefront. And I thank you for it. In the most high name, incredible Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated this morning. I want to talk about the church, the remnant, the body of Christ, the created, the declared, the prophetic, the not pathetic, come on now, but prophetic. God did not call a pathetic church. He called a prophetic church. God didn't call us to be pathetic either, and we're not. God called us to be prophetic, to speaking the word, declaring what God's word says, declaring who we are and whose we are. If you ever forget where you're at in your journey, don't ever forget that you are the church and you serve the living God. If you forget sometimes, Satan just deceives you into thinking, causing you to ponder on things that are less than what God says you are, just stop it and say, no, I am part of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, the church. We're in a beautiful edifice this morning. This church, not just building, but the church has an incredible history of strong, of strength, of serving the Lord, of passion after the Lord, not pride, but yes, thankful for where God has brought them to. Just so happened this past week, I was looking and I came across in my notes in my computer the history that we had written out of the church, and I believe it all goes back to like 1947 or so, back down on somewhere on King Street, and then eventually on Mulberry, is that it? I believe it is. And then under Brother Hughes, I believe he's the one that bought the property during his ministry. And then I believe under Gary Wilson that eventually came out here. And there's church, even in the midst of it, churches that came together, two churches joined together and became First Assembly of God. I mean, you know, we come in here on a Sunday morning and think about the now, but sometimes it's good to be put into remembrance of what was done, the historical value of this church and what God created this to be. Now, however, I want to quickly take your attention off of just our church, but take your attention on the church, that we are part of the universal church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not walls, physically speaking, but folks, there are some spiritual walls that he has erected in the church. And God wants to do something new. I want you to stay with me. I'm going to get into some awesome stuff, I believe. I mean, I think it's awesome. You may not. If you don't, that's okay. Just sit there and act like you do. And Just take it, and it might, and just let it stew inside of you. Today, some of you may be like a crock pot. It may take a while for it to get where it's supposed to be. Some of you may be like you're right on the burner, and you've been frying it up today, and you're just eating it, you know. But sometimes these things need to stew a little bit. Sometimes it needs, and so you might need to take a couple of notes this morning or write the scripture down, something that stands out to you. I invite you to keep your thoughts and attention with us this morning. Don't get distracted. You know, I know at times people may have to get up and go back there, or a child may have to go out, or somebody may have to go to work. Just stay connected. Just say, God bless you, and just stay connected. Amen? God's got something for you. Time is not late, so I'm going to jump in here. Moses, my servant, is dead, and therefore the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land that I'm giving you. 2016, I'm telling you, I love my wife, because not only is she an incredible, beautiful woman, and who's been my wife for almost 35 years, she is a woman of God. And my wife walks in discernment. I have been touched many times, or kept from many times. Cheryl will speak something to me and say, watch this, understand this is what. And I'm telling you, you know, God don't always speak to me. God will speak to her before he speaks to me. How many know that's okay? Man, get your pride out of the way and think you're supposed to know everything. Sometimes God will use your wife, and sometimes he may use you. It doesn't matter. He's just using y'all. Come on, amen. And so God has spoken some things to her concerning not just the church universal, but the church corporate here where God's brought us. Thank God for the church. Thank God for the church universe. Thank God for, and I'm not going to even speak denominationally. I'm talking about the church that's blood-bought, that believes in Jesus Christ. I'm talking about the true church. Let me tell you, there's some things that's got church on it, but it's not the church, because it does not believe in the inerrancy of the Word of God. It does not believe in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, and does not believe that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today forever, and don't believe that even the Bible is really all what it says it is, and believes a whole lot of other things. I'm talking about the church that was born on the cross, that Jesus died for us, rose again, and he's coming back. Amen. That's the kind of church I'm talking about, that believe that Jesus Christ is everything. I'm not talking about denominationally that believe in Jesus and the cross, but might believe, maybe see it just a little bit differently, whatever. As long as we got the bottom fellowship foundation that Jesus Christ is the Lord of our life, we got something in common. Amen. So, last year, God gave a word to Cheryl, and I took it to preach. She gave the word, God gave her the word remnant, that God is raising up a church that may, it's the word that means leftover, and I'll get it more into that in a moment. And in 2017, God impressed upon her, gave her another thought, and I'm running with this as well, that we are a remnant, yes, but God has taken us through change and surplus. How many want to catch on to that word this morning? Amen. God, we've been talking about change, but God wants to do a surplus. Now, surplus is not just a resource issue of financial means. I believe that is a part of it, and I want that in my life. How many want financial resource in your life? Now, if you want it just so you'll have a great retirement, you're asking for the wrong thing. God wants to give so you can give. See, God wants to raise up a generation of givers. Y'all excited about that, aren't you? God wants to raise up a church that are givers, not takers and receivers. It's more blessed to what? Than to. Boy, y'all got it now. So God is raising up something that is kind of against our normality of or our normal thinking of, yeah, I like this, I want this, and I see this. And we are hit and bombarded daily with things that we don't have and think that we need it. Let me ask you this. What do you really need? I mean, understand what you need and what you want are two totally separate things. I mean, I can go in the store, into the grocery store, whichever one that might be, and I can see a lot of things I want. I mean, Cheryl, I think, has learned, maybe I hate to shop by myself. She gives me I'll take a list, but if you just go, well, just go get what we need. I'll come back with ice cream, cake, and chips, and pretzels, and so I can see a lot of things I need or I won't, but it may not be on the need list. Same thing in this world. There's a lot of things that we would like, that we think we need, but really it is a want, it's a desire. Thank God he gives us desires, but God has a place that what we need, that God wants to take us into a change and a surplus. That change and surplus, yes, I believe it's going to affect us resource-wise, that this church can give even more. But folks, I would invite your attention to the thought that God wants to bring supernatural resources that is not just in the financial realm, but that this church is a place of healing. This church is a place of liberty. This church is a place that blind eyes are open, lives are restored, marriages are healed. Got a call Friday, and Freddie Woods, I'm not sure if many of you know, Lynette and Joyce, sisters and niece, thank you. And I'm glad you pronounced, because that sometimes. and of course, you're going on a missile trip with us. Hallelujah. And we have a great time. So, got a call that since he had his kidney transplant, he's had a struggle. Just a real, Tara would tell you and testify to that. It's just been, but I'd heard that within the last few weeks there had been some good change, and I think it was Lynette or Joyce had taken him to Walmart or something. But last week, and I've got a reason sharing all this, that he had a stroke, blinded one of his eyes. He had another stroke, blinded the other. And then Friday, I think it was, Friday morning, he got up. They had the nursing home, and he was unresponsive. And he's been on life support. So they called me, and I met him. I went down there and saw him, and first, we prayed to talk together, to Sister Lynette and Joyce, and then we went into the hospital, went into the ICU, and he was there on the breathing machine, and very, you know, if you just take it just as it is, it looks almost hopeless. You think, okay, God, what can change here? Well, see, I've already experienced and seen things that has changed, and so, I mean, honestly, the doctors were already talking to them about changing the code to DNR. I mean, just preparing the family, the daughter. I'm not sure if both daughters have come in yet here. Oh, hallelujah. God provided a miracle for them to come in. And but I got a text just, I believe it was yesterday. So as I was praying, or as not just I was praying, as we were there, well, I mean, it had nothing to do with me. I mean, I take no credit. But as we were there, he was moving. And we would talk, and he was kind of acting like, I mean, his eyes were still shut. He was still on the breathing machine, but there was some movement there. And, you know, it was really, really encouraging. And so, I'm talking while I'm looking for this. Here's what the text says. It says, Pastor, I just wanted you to know that Freddie has been opening his eyes and moving his head for his daughters. He is trying to verbalize by moving his jaw a little. Please continue your prayers and support. Thank you so much. And by the way, you are welcome, as well as the rest of the church, to call or text me. Can you shout hallelujah? Amen. Now, that's God. That's what God, I heard, Betty, I think I heard you say, a healing revival. God is doing things like we've never seen. The people that know their God should do great exploits. Isaiah 10:21 says it this way: a remnant will return. Yes, the remnant of Jacob, and return to the mighty God. I will preserve a remnant, Isaiah 65:9 says, of the people of Israel and of Judah to possess my land. Those I choose will inherit it, and my servants will live there. You may think we're up against and we're a minority, and in a lot of respects, the church is the church of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ in this world in these last days. But God said, I've got a remnant. I've got a people that's not going to bow. I have a people that's going to stand. I have a people, it may look sometimes kind of rough on the outside, but I've got a people that's going to come through it. They're not just going to come through and say, phew, that was close. They're going to come through with victory and anointing, and they're going to bring the sheaves or the seed, the people that God has healed, that God has touched, that the resources of God became our resources, that we could say, God, you gave us authority. Come on now. Go to Joel 2:28. I got to take you several places to get you where we need to be this morning. Joel chapter 2. I want you to connect. I don't want you to just hear me preach. I want you to connect and get this in your heart, because you are the church. I got to remind, I need to be reminded, and you need to be reminded who we are and what we are. Joel 2:28 says, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. Joel 2:29. Verse 30 says, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. And the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and the terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Can somebody here call on the name of the Lord with me this morning? Amen. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. God is saying, not just in Jerusalem shall be found deliverance, but in the remnant as well, whom the Lord has called. I want to remind you, you are in the remnant of grace that God has called. And God said, in that remnant, there will be deliverance, saith the Lord. How many of you need deliverance this morning in some area of life? God said, there will be deliverance in your midst. Just a little background, it was a time of corruption and open sin and compromise that had overtaken a tremendous portion of the people of God. And it started at the top and worked its way through the entire body. And here the Lord, in verse 12 through 17, he instructs his people what must take place before he can move on their behalf. In Joshua 2, he tells them to turn to him with their whole heart. Folks, you'll never get anything from God without turning to him with your whole heart. God still believes in repentance. Oh, come on now, don't get quiet on me. He says, turn with your whole heart, fasting, weeping, and mourning. He said, rend your hearts and not your garments. He said, sanctify fast and weep between, call a solemn assembly. He said, sanctify, set apart. Joel, the congregation, tell them who they are. Set them apart. They've not been bought for this world. They've not been bought just for their families. They've been set apart for the purposes of God. Stay with me now. So he says, sanctify the congregation. Have the priest weep between the porch and the altar, crying out to the Lord to spare the people before they go further into bondage. In other words, he says, repent. Jesus said many times, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. In the midst of this corruption, God in his mercy and grace instructs his people to come back to him, a person who can be trusted to complete his plan. And the Bible says in verse 32, it shall come to pass that whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, shall be delivered, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Now go to Romans chapter 11 quickly. I'm talking about the remnant. Romans 11, verse 1. If you can't get there, write it down. If you got a phone and you got our app on here, or you can get on the webpage, go to CFA Guess and put that in there. And you can go, you can find scripture there if you need to be there. Or through that portal. Romans 11:1 says, I ask then, Did God reject his people? Paul said, by no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Let me tell you, let me just stop there just for a brief second. God knew all about you and still died for you. God knew your ups, downs, your good, the bad, the ugly, and he still went to the cross for you. So the word says, don't you know what scripture says, verse number 2, in the passage about Elijah, how he appealed to God about Israel, against Israel. Remember when he stood up against Ahab and Jezebel and the prophets of Baal and all these prophets, they had kind of a spiritual contest and had a sacrifice and whoever called upon their gods and burn up the sacrifice, then they would serve that God. If Baal is God, serve Baal. If God is God, serve God. Of course, Baal's prophets, all this, and these were Israelites. Baals, these were people of God that had turned. Let me remind you about this. These were people of God that God chose, and they had turned because they ran after false gods. Had a puppet king by the name of King Ahab who would rather serve flesh and his wife than serve God. His wife Jezebel, a devil. I said that. She was demonic. But God called Elijah, and they had a showdown. And let me tell you, it was an awesome showdown. The Bible says Elijah, he'll give them the chance. Call out to your God. They called out all day long, cut themselves even, and cried out and nothing. And then Elijah, I'm going to kind of throw my stuff in here. You know, I'm not saying what I say is anointed, what God's word is. But let me just kind of get my little paraphrase in here, my little 2 cents here. He said, okay, now it's my time. Y'all have called out all day long and y'all haven't gotten anything. No response. He says, my turn. He said, God, would you show these people who you are? I don't have to call you twice. I don't have to call out and cry out, cut myself and do anything else. You are the God of Abraham, Isaac. I'm just throwing my stuff in here. You are the God that can, you're the God that can show them up. And all of a sudden, God's power and lightning and fire came down from the midst of heaven and burned up all the sacrifice and all the water that they had drawn in. What was it, 12 barrels full, things roughly full, and it was water everywhere, but it licked up every bit and burnt the sacrifice, everything. And the people fell down and said, God, he is God. He is the Lord. He is the Lord. And they killed the prophets of Baal, and then Jezebel set in. Said, Elijah, just what you did to my prophets, he said. She said, I'm going to kill you. After the most powerful victory, the Bible says, he ran and he wanted to die. Be careful that you think just because you got one victory that you're guaranteed the next road to be victorious, because it's after some of the most powerful victories that you'll have some of those powerful battles, because what is anointed, Satan will hit. How many's found that out to be true? What is anointed, Satan will try it, he'll hit it, he'll try to destroy it. He knows he can't, but he's out to destroy you, because in the midst, if we can't trust what's been tested, if we can't trust what God has said, and we falter back like Elijah did, and Elijah went through this tirade of different, wanted to die and upset about this and all, you know, and then finally he went all the way away and got to a point there in the cave, and God spoke in that still small voice, and Elijah cried out. He said, he had this spiritual pride about him. He said, I'm the only one that's left that's really serving you, God. In other words, God, there's nobody like me. If we ever get to that place where we think we're something special, we just found out how prideful we are. And God can't use that. That's just a thought there. The Bible says, Elijah said, there's no one but me. And then God said, verse number 2, he said, Lord, they have killed, verse 3, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars, Romans 11, 3. And I am the only one left, and they are trying to kill me, verse 4. And what was God's answer to him, to Elijah? He said, I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. When you think you're all alone and there's nobody else, let me tell you, God's got somebody in the wings there that's got still serving God. God's got somebody that's going to come along beside you. You're not the only one, but if you are the only one, he is the God that'll never leave you. He'll never leave his church because he said the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Stay with me now. Paul reached back into 1 Kings to show that God had always had a faithful remnant, even in the times of greatest unbelief. Because even as we read Old Testament history, you can't help but be impressed with the fact it was always, if you'll read historically speaking, it was always the remnant that God used and God blessed. Romans 11:5 states that God has a remnant. Now here it is. Verse 5 says, so too, at the present time, not thousands of years earlier with the Elijah and Elisha, but now Paul was saying, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. Oh, come on, y'all can shout on that one. There's a remnant that's talking about us. That's the church. There's a supernatural body of believers. We've not been chosen by how we look. We've not been chosen because of all the accolades we have. We've been chosen because God's grace, he foreknew, foresaw, and foreordained that we would be the people of God. We're people of grace. That word remnant is remaining, what is left over, usually small part, a fragment or a scrap or unsold or unused piece of cloth. The word remnant in the Hebrew is the word shahar. It means a remainder. The remnant is the group that always stood firm in times where truth was absent. Let me tell you, church, here at First Assembly, you are not here by chance. You are part of the last day remnant of God that's standing strong. It doesn't matter what everybody else is going to do. This church is going to stand strong. It doesn't matter what everybody the family is going to do. We make a decision. Joshua, he said, choose you this day whom you'll serve. But as for me and my house, God has given me authority and charge over this house. God, as for me and my house, First Assembly of God here at Charleston, South Carolina on 2957 Savannah Highway. I don't know what everybody else may do, but this church is going to stand strong in grace. We're going to stay strong in the grace of God. My family, men of God, God has given you. Come on, guys. Don't wait on your wife. She's not the one to do this. God has called you, men of God, to stand up and say, my house will be a house that serves God. My house will be a house that trusts God. We're the remnant. God does not call the biggest or the best. He doesn't call the richest or those with the most finesse. He calls those who are willing to listen to his call for service. He even told the Israelites, he said in Deuteronomy 7, he said, the Lord did not set his love upon you nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you and because he would keep the oath which he swore unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Then he says, know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that loves him and keeps his commandments to 1,000 generations. I didn't start to preach yet. Y'all hang on. Go to Colossians 1. Well, maybe I have a little bit. Excuse me, 1 Corinthians 1. Scripture says, I believe it's the Message translation, it says, take a good look, friends, at who you were when you got called into this life. Don't be offended by this, but the scripture says, and Message translation says, I don't see many of the brightest and the best among you. Not many influential, not many from high society families. Verse 27, he says, isn't it obvious that God deliberately chose men and women that the culture overlooks and exploits and abuses? Choose these nobodies to expose the hollow pretensions of the somebodies. Verse 29, he said, that makes it quite clear that none of you can get by with blowing your own horn before God. Everything that we have, right thinking and right living, a clean slate and a fresh start, comes from God by way of Jesus Christ. Verse 31 says, Message translation says, that's why we have the saying, if you're going to blow a horn, blow a trumpet for God. Can somebody blow some praise out for God, because we're lost without him. Come on, amen. Time and time again, God chose the remnant. Look in Gideon's life. The angel of God coming and said, "Hail, thou mighty man of God." And Gideon was probably saying, "God, who are you? You're not talking to me because I'm nobody. I'm hiding in the wine press just to have some food for my family." Because the Midianites were stealing everything and destroying everything. And of course, they were in a place of judgment. That's why the Midianites were there. They were there in disobedience. But aren't you glad even our disobedience, God will, when we cry out to God, he will see us. And when we repent before God, God will send the answer to our lives. The idea of a remnant is nothing new. For thousands of years, Satan has tried to destroy the very foundation God's laid for us. And even when you study the Old Testament, you'll find that the Bible speaks over and over about remnants that remained after the great massacres of God's people. They were people who were called to be separated and to stand during wicked times, much less like this, just like these times today. I got to challenge you, stand. When you've done all else to stand, stand with your feet girded with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Stand with the sword of the Spirit. Stand with the breastplate of righteousness. Stand with the belt of truth, because you can know the truth and the truth will set you free. Come on, stand with the shield of faith. When you don't know what else to do, just stand and let God take care of the rest. Come on, church, stand. No, not literally right now, just stand. Come on, stand. Come on, just stand. When you want to give up, stand. When you're tempted to do that thing, stop it, stand. When Satan would tell you it's not worth it, you stand. When Satan says, "Well, look what everybody else is doing. Look what I'm going to do, Satan. I'm going to stand." When God's word seemingly is not coming to pass yet, and you're caught in between of God said and then God did, and you don't know when it's going to take place, God says, "Be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not." Stand. That's what the church does when it gets tough. They stand. God has always had a people within a people. Whether Caleb and Joshua during the time of Moses, Nehemiah, Daniel, the three Hebrew children during the Babylonian captivity, the 7,000 who didn't bow to the knee of Baal. God has always had a group that stood. How about here? Is there a group that'll stand here? Is there a group that'll be faithful? When it's easy to stay home and I've worked all week long and I just don't feel like being church. Is there a group of people that'll say, "I'll still be in the house of God because he's called me to stand"? Now, folks, if you got the flu and you're sneezing and blowing and everything, go, please stand at home. And we'll send prayer for you, because I don't want it in the name of Jesus. But sometimes one of the hardest things to do is to get, I'm going to speak some now. I'm going to start preaching now. That was all intro. Some of the hardest things sometimes to do is get people to be committed to the house of God and to be the church. You know what? When I was raised up, I didn't have any question where I would be on Sunday morning. Whether I wanted to or not, I knew at 9:45 I'd be in Sunday school, and at 10:45 I'd be sitting on the pew in the church. Now, I might have been playing, I might have been running, and Dad ran after me. Well, not literally, but he caught me at home. My dad didn't care what everybody else thought and what I thought. He'd call me down from the very front and from the pulpit and say, "Charles, find a place with your mama." And mom sits on second row. I was raised to respect the house of God. I was raised to be faithful to the house of God. I was raised to know about prayer. I was raised to tithe. I was raised to give 10%. I was raised and learned what it was, even at an age. You know, I remember I won the contest. I was there all the time or something other, and I got $10. I was raised, okay, you owe a dollar of that. I mean, as a kid, you had to do it. I was raised that way. I'm raised that if I make $200, $20 is not mine. Well, actually, $200 is not mine. God just lets me keep $180. Now, if I'm getting in your business, so be it. I'll get in your business today. A Okay, I'm going to hit us all. I was raised to be on time. I didn't come in at 11 o'clock. You know, if we treated our job the way we treat our church sometimes, we would all be losers at our job. Now, don't be bowing your head and say, oh, Jesus, he's talking about me. God, I'm so sorry. Don't. No, just take it if I am and take it. God, I got a word today. Come on now. Come on, turn to somebody and say, that's a word. Bible says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. It's where we provoke, we'll not provoke people to get mad at us, but we provoke or encourage people to do good works. We need you. We need each other, and we need him, and we need to be committed to the house of God. You know, it's kind of like the statement many have said, you know, well, how many church run or whatever? He said, well, if everybody came on the same Sunday and shocked everybody, you know, if everybody did this, you know, we'd be over 300 plus. Everybody says that, hey, this is our church. Everybody smile. This is good stuff. This is just practical stuff. Sometimes we need to do some house cleaning in the house of God. Come on now. We need to do some house cleaning. Sometimes laundry piles up and you get to the place. Okay, is there any more towels? No, they're all in the laundry. And who wants to use a dirty... You go in your underwear drawer. Hey, there's none... I don't even know. You know where I'm at. We've all been there. You get busy and everything else, and then God's raising up a remnant church. He will always have a faithful people. I said he'll always have a faithful people. He said we're people chosen by grace. The church, he says, arise and shine, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. I want you to do something. I'm going to give you the words. I want you to tell somebody, or I want you to tell it to yourself. If you want to look at somebody and just encourage them with this, or if you want to be encouraged yourself like David did, say these words with me. Say them to yourself. Say them to somebody. Arise and shine. Come on, let's say it with vigor. Let's say it with excitement. Arise and shine. For your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. Hallelujah, that's a prophetic statement. It's time. This is the year of the remnant. And this is the year of change and surplus. This is the year of healing revival. This is the year of dead bones coming back to life. This is the year that the old is gone, the new has come. It's a year of change. It's the year of new. It's a year of following. It's a year of holiness. It's a year that things are changing day by day inside of us. I believe it's a year of the remnant. God says many are invited, but few are chosen. Many get invited, but only a few make it because they choose not to make it. But I challenge you with these words. The world is desperate to see an authentic church. Much of the church has removed itself from the original intent of Jesus Christ. God has called us to live our lives in the image of our Savior. But instead, we bear his name. Many who bear his name look nothing like him. But a remnant church looks and behaves like Jesus. It loves what he loves. It hates what he hates. A remnant church will be a supernatural church. And as never before in human history, there's a clear call for the authentic remnant of God to rise up and say, I am part of the blood-bought church of the living God. Bible says in John 6:66, after the Lord taught a very hard word about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. The Bible says in verse 66 of John 6, after this, a lot of his disciples left. They are no longer wanted to be associated with him. And Jesus looked at the 12. He said, you guys, do y'all want to leave too? And I love what Peter said. He said, Master, to whom would we go? Because you have the words of real life, eternal life. And verse 69, he said, we've already committed ourselves, confident that you are the Holy one of God. What began with 12 increased to 120. Well, 12 minus 1, then plus 1 after the on the day of Pentecost. 120 there in the upper room. It grew to 3,000. It grew to 5,000 in later pages. And then ultimately it turned the world upside down. And now millions upon millions upon millions of people that are in the remnant of God that will not bow to the world's ideas and philosophies and the world's idea quote of truth. But we have stood strong on absolute truth that nothing changes the gospel. Nothing changes who Jesus is, because he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Everybody changes not. I got to tell you, number one, a remnant church has a builder. No, it does not fit my head, and no, it's. But a remnant church, how many know what this is? When do they wear hard hats? No, not in your marriage, but no, if we're. How many's ever seen the sign that it says hard hats, hard hat area, hard hats required? How many understand before a building goes up, the idea has to be there to put something there? Hours and hours of planning, hours and hours of thinking through. First, there has to be a vision, a plan, a thought. Financing then. Well, before financing, an architect is hired. Well, you got to have enough finance to get an architect. Architect is hired. An architect, y'all know what this is? Say it again. Y'all know what this is the blueprint of? Right where you're sitting right now. Isn't this pretty up here? Aren't y'all just financing secured, permits are secured, and then the dirt, it begins to move on the planned side of the building, and a foundation eventually comes up. A foundation is planned. It'll just fall. There. A foundation is built, is poured. Eventually steel columns, if it's a steel building, it starts going up as we see the girders here. Beams start appearing. Eventually the building is enclosed with the walls. Inside the walls are painted. And eventually there's a grand opening. The building is able to have the occupancy certificate and they can walk in, whether it's a church or it's a mall or whatever it is. It's an interesting thought that Jesus talked about. You know, it's kind of like a guy, a group or whatever that wanted to build, but they had to check first that they had the resources to build so that when it came down to the end, they'd have enough to cover everything down to the very end. How many do you have what it takes to build in the kingdom of God? You got to count the cost. How many's got what it takes to go all the way? You can look all around Charleston and find buildings that started but never got finished because there wasn't enough money to take care of it all the way to the end. What I'm telling you this morning is this. You better count the cost when you start serving Jesus Christ, because there is a cost. No, yes, it's free. Jesus died for us and rose again. But there's a cost of commitment. There's a cost of prayer. There's a cost of sacrifice. There's a cost of living for him with all of our heart, soul, and mind. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, saying, whom do men say? I'm going to ask our worship team to come. Whom do men say that I am, the Son of God am? And they said, some say you're the John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he said unto them, but whom say you that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto you also unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Then he goes on to say, and I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. How many would call Jesus the owner of the land? How many would call Jesus the architect? How many would call him the source? How many would call him the builder? So financing is secured. Bible says, come all you who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Financing is in his hands. It does not cost us a thing. Can I tell you, the permits are secured for the building God has given us. See, the Bible says that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. He said, I've given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy, and nothing will harm you. Let me tell you, God has given his authority to you to build what he's building. The foundation is poured, or I should say, the dirt begins to move on the planned side of the building. Who is the church? Thank you. I want to remind you, you were formed from the dust of the ground. The Bible says, basically lets us know that sin buried us. But scripture tells us in the book of Psalms, he took us out of the deep miry clay and he put our feet on the rock to stay, because now he is the potter, and he began to take that lump of dirt and clay and began to mold us into the building and fashioned us into the building that would only be for him, for his glory. He said, I will build my church. He's the potter and we are the clay. Dirt begins to move, because he's building something in us. You may not be there yet, but God's moving dirt. God's got the big machines in. He may sometimes move and excavate some things in your life. God may be digging up some things so we can fill in with something that's a whole lot better. Come on now. Then he pours a foundation. You know what your foundation is? Ephesians 2:20 says, you are built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm. Then the steel starts going up. Beams start appearing. The frame of the building goes into place. Can I tell you that God walls you in? He gives you a stability. That truth is your framework. Come on, stand with me. The truth, that belt of truth, is what gives you stability when the wind blows. Buildings now have to be built to be able to handle wind in excess of whatever, hurricane force. There's always going to be attacks on the church of God, but the truth of God gives us that stability. The Bible says, you know the truth and the truth will set you free. You know, we can either be like the foolish builder that builds it on sand, and when the storms come and when the winds blow, the Bible says that house did not stand. But it also says, but we can be like the wise builder. We built our house on the rock, and when the storms come and all this happens, we stay strong. Because we've been walled in. We've been built on the foundation. Stay with me now. I'm almost done. I'm not going to preach a long time now. I'm done. Nevertheless, God's foundation stands firm. Then the walls go up. The Bible says, in him the whole building's joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. You see, the walls get put in. You know who the walls are? Come here, Daryl. Come here, Tony. Come here, Tony. Come here, Toby. Come here, sister. I'll get the name out here in a second. Sister Graciela. Come here, Chris. Come here, Larry. Come here, Clarice. Come here, James. Melissa, come here. Now, won't you stand right here? Come here, Tank. Lynn, why don't you come stand by him, because you're part of his wall too. And see, these walls get built up. And so, come here, Scott. Oh, come on with him. Come on. I'll walk slow. See, sometimes even the weaker times, we still stand strong around those that are weak at times, because we are the walls. And yeah, that's you. Yeah, come on. Yeah, come on. Julie, come on. So you stand, you're the walls. Just stand right there. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Anybody else want to stand? Come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. We need people that's been in it a long time. Cheryl, come here. Where'd you come from? See, God just did something in you. God's changing you. See, you don't have to be invited by the church to the wall. God invites you. Come on, come here, come here, Amanda. Anybody else want to be on the wall? Come on, come on. I need several more to step out. Come on, come on. This wall needs to go all the way. Come on. Do you know what happened last week? Can I say it? She gave her heart to the Lord Jesus Christ last Sunday morning. Come on, come on, come on, the wall. Come on, come on, walk, walk, walk. See, this is the wall. It's the wall. It's the wall. It's part of the wall. Come here, come here, come here, Sharon, yo, yo. Come here, Ken. Come on, come on, you're... Come on, this wall needs somebody. Okay, I'm not going to call all y'all by name. Somebody got to step out. Come on, stand here. Go all. See, the church is not church at 2957 Savannah Highway. Somebody needs to keep the wall going. Somebody needs to keep, because we're, come here, Ron. Come here, come here, come here, come here, come here. Come on, because you're strong in the Lord, and you're part of the wall. Come on, come on, Michelle. We need children's pastors. And where's y'all's wall over there? No, you see, that's the problem happens. I'm gonna get right here. We don't build our own wall, because our wall, we can't. We have to build what's part of Jesus' wall. So what we need this coming off this side. Come here, Martha. Come on, come on, come on. Come here, come here, come here, come here. Come on, come on, come on. No, don't go back to the church. Go out of the church. And yeah. So you start right here, because we're going this way now. This wall goes all kind of ways. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come stand. Come here, Laura and Ron. Oh, we love y'all. Come on, come on. You're part of the wall. Y'all just prayed I'm gonna come get y'all. You got my point? You're the walls. You're the body. You're the body. And without you, the church is weak. That's why it's of importance to stay with the church. You're the walls. Come on, join hands. Or join shoulders. Join link arms. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, now everybody stand and go get on the wall. Everybody get on the wall. Everybody. Is that everybody? Somebody say everybody. Why don't? Okay. What if there are not enough people on the wall? Then what's the church to do? Everybody start waving this way. How many understand it says go into all the world and preach the gospel? Suppose do that. Because we want to build the wall. God's building something in us. Sometimes people physically or spiritually are hurting, and they feel all alone, and they have no strength. So what's the wall supposed to do then? Well, I ain't seen nobody come get me yet. Hallelujah. Somebody, glory to God. You see? Well, they're just, we're going to separate from them. Why? We're part of the wall. And our wall is just not here. Our wall is around the world. Supernaturally speaking, there's people joining. At the very end, we're Charles. Hey, Charles. It just keeps going. It's not us four and no more. It's all of us. We want the wall to grow. He's walled us in. Say with me, I am the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's still building me. How many will stand as a protective force for each other? But you know how Earl Peebles is. You know, I heard something about him the other day. Well, you ain't heard what I heard. Hey, Brother Peebles, how are you doing? I love you so much. What, did you hear what Earl did? You know what? I just don't like that pastor. What does that pastor's wife think she is? Look what she's wearing. Do you see who just came in the door? Can you believe they came here? They look. They got tattoos and they look like the world. I don't like our music, do you? It ought to be for us, not for somebody else. You could find a lot of people, that's the most boringest church I've ever been in. And 1,000, and another, and 1,000, and another lies upon lies upon lies upon lies will hit our ears to make us divide the walls. Are you with me? Somebody has got to stand up. Say, that's not the man you're talking about. We're going to go to him ourselves right now. And you tell him what you just said. Oh, no, no, no. Well, they are saying this. Who is the they? It's always they. Well, come on now. And Satan is trying to break the wall down. How many will stand strong with your brother and sister and say, no, I will not gossip. I will not tear my brother down. I will not tear my sister down. I'll go to them face to face. And all kind of other things will try to break the wall down. Somebody shout, I'm the wall. I'm the wall. I'll be the wall. And I'll stand strong.